లతా మ్యామ్
మేడం
లతా మ్యామ్ మేము మీకు హోస్ట్ పెట్టేస్తా మీకు ఇబ్బంది లేకుండా ఉంటది
ఓకే
ఓకేనా మ్యామ్
ఓకే ఓకే
రైట్ ఇంకా అడ్మిట్ చేయలేదు అందరినీ మీ ఒక్కరిని అడ్మిట్ చేసిన అదే ఒక విషయం చెప్పి హోస్ట్ చేసేస్తా చేసిన తర్వాత శ్రీకాంత్ కు తర్వాత మీ ప్రోగ్రామ్ కాగానే శ్రీకాంత్ కు హోస్ట్ పెట్టేయండి
ఓకే
ఓకేనా 107 మెంబర్స్ వచ్చారు మ్యామ్ ఇప్పటికి
ఓకే
Good evening to all participants. We are 15 minutes late now. Lata ma'am?
Yes, sir.
Madam, please continue, ma'am.
Yeah. Sir, you can make, if Srikant sir is there, sir, you can make Srikant sir.
Madam, good evening, madam.
Srikant sir, you can make me as co-host, sir. You can be as host. Yeah, if co-host is there also, I can share the slides.
Okay.
That's not an issue. because if the current goes here, it's better you be the host, no? You can give it to anyone.
Okay, ma'am. Okay.
Lata ma'am?
Yes, sir. Shall I start? Or
madam,
we'll wait for two
madam
minutes?
First, madam, yes. First you have to make Srikanth as host, madam.
Achha, you made me host already.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
I'll just check it out, sir. One minute.
Okay, ma'am.
Lata?
Yes.
Hello. Lata madam. Hi. I know. I'm good. How much time you'll need for this?
Most probably it will take 1 hour or less than 1 hour only.
Okay. Thank you.
Sir, it is showing Prashant Kumar. Srikanth DOP is showing as Prashant Kumar.
Myself for Srikanth DPO, I named it as now.
Acha, okay. Then I made it, sir. You can make me as co-host, sir. But it is showing for Prashant Kumar only host, sir.
Yes, madam. You made it as Prashant sir, madam.
Okay, I'm sorry. One second.
Prashant Kumar host.
No, I am changing it. Oh, he only can change, I think, now. Is he there or he left?
Srikanth DPO, you are host, no? You can change it.
Yeah. It is done now. Srikanth DPO is host.
Okay, madam. I'm changing.
Yeah, you make me co-host so that I can share the slides. So Jyoti, next is your class. Hello. Yeah, thank you, sir.
Pusha, you now you are co-host, even you are done.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, shall we start? They are already 186.
Yes. We are eagerly waiting.
I hope I don't disappoint you.
Never.
Okay, nice.
Madam, you start. It's already 10 to 5. You start.
Yeah.
Join. Yeah. They will join.
Madam, I'm waiting for third presentation. Seal number 3.
That's why I'm asking Lata ma'am to start.
Give me a minute. Okay. Right. So, good evening, everyone. This is Lata Madhavi from Zairabad Girls High School, working as school assistant English. And today, I'm with you all to just share my point of view regarding the reading component. And almost all of our teachers have a big question mark when it comes to the reading of unknown text. So today I'm here to discuss with you all about this. So when I am just taking the class, maybe I would prefer to go in an interactive mode. Without that, I feel that I'm lost in a room and I'm not finding anyone. So I request the host, sir, to just whoever raises the hand, you can tell their name, sir, so that they can unmute and speak. Only the people's name whose it is announced can unmute. Okay. Maybe I also can read the name if you're raising the hand. So whomever I say or Srikanth sir says, you can just unmute yourself and speak. Others, please be in mute so that you will not disturb us. So it's a kind request from my side to all the participants. So let us go for the class. So I hope you all have certain illusions about this. So today I'm here to clear those. To what extent I can do, I will help you all out. Let us learn together if something more is also needed. So I welcome you all for the fourth day's session. And this is about reading unknown text. So are you all ready? So please raise your hand if you all want to answer something. If you answer, I'll be more motivated to speak. Yes, regarding this reading unknown text. So every one of us feel that we concentrate a lot on 10th class and we concentrate very little on 6th and 7th classes, I should tell. Because we feel that 6th and 7th is not that important, but 10th is very, very important because they are going to reach out for public exams, which is not very right on our part, I feel. Because 6th is the basic foundation which we lay for the child to help him out to attend the examination in 10th class. So to attend 10th class exam, we just can't go and read in 10th class and get pass marks. But the foundation should be laid right from first class, if I'm not wrong. But sometimes we all complain that the primary schools are not working properly or the teachers are not taking care of the children properly. So the children come to us without learning ABC. And this is a very strong sentence we always keep telling to ourselves. But when the child comes to 6th class and he reaches to 10th class and still he is not able to read certain text, then whom are we going to blame? So let us not do that from today. So how we can help our children to read it, we'll just see. So according to you all, what do you think that the child, or how do you think the child reads certain text? Anyone can answer? How do the children read the text? So, none of them want to answer? Right. So, let me help you all out. Maybe the child reads in this way. Letter to letter, word to word, and sentence to sentence, and some of them can read a paragraph. So what does this letter to letter mean, according to you all? Can anyone? Did you ever experience about this in your classes?
Spelling, they read out the word with spelling.
Yeah, some of them read out only the spelling. Not even word. They don't utter the word. They just say T-H-E-C-O-M-E. So that says that the child is able to understand only the letter. Not more than that. And word to word. So some of them, as Usha was telling, some of them read it as T-H-E the. Then C-O-M-E come. So they do this from word to word, like they spell out the letter and then to the word. So this is this we can see in many of the children who come to sixth class. And very few of them, if suppose the classes of 25 or 30, around 5 to 6 children alone can read only sentence to sentence. But most of them cannot sense the meaning of the sentence. They can read the sentence, no doubt about it. But they cannot sense the meaning of the sentence. And some children can very easily read, like 2 to 3 children hardly in our classes can read paragraphs, if I'm not wrong. Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes. So this is how our children read. So this problem is prevailing since very long years, like so many years, almost the day I have joined into the service, till today, I still find that classes. So how are we going to address this? How many of you really give chance for the children to read on their own? And how many of you still feel that the time is running out and the syllabus is to be completed? Can you all raise your hands and say me so that I can just have a count of it? Yeah, so three participants, four, fine. So you still feel that this is to be addressed. So what is the problem you think for the child who is reading letter to letter? Yes, the letter to letter, whichever child reads, is he has made an impression of certain letters with the sounds, but he doesn't know how to club the sounds. So that is his problem. He knows individual sound of that letter, but he don't know the mixed sound of that combination of those letters. Suppose T-H-E, the, T-H-E, all are different sounds, but all together it is spelled as the or the, whatever you use. So that says the clubbing of sounds is not possible with that child, and that child needs a special attention of clubbing the sounds. And you have to teach him how the certain sounds are to be clubbed and pronounced. So this is the need of the child, but the teacher is giving him the total text, which just the teacher reads and finishes and explains it in Telugu or in English and finishes the class. So that may not be addressed even when the child reaches his 10th class. Automatically, the anxiety or the confusion or the the confusion of the child is on to the extreme extent that the child switches off himself from the class. And he doesn't even think what the teacher or his surroundings are doing. He just switches off from the class, and he lands up in his own world where he finds his own enjoyment, his own happiness. That's the reason why our children are not able to read certain text. So here the teacher is supposed to give practice on sounds and clubbing of sounds. And we also said that the child is able to read words, but the words, clubbing of sounds is okay, but he's coming to words, but he doesn't know the meaning of words. That means there was no good practice of association of word to the picture or word to the surroundings or word to the action. So this has not happened with the child. So this is again a big problem where the teacher is either ready to show with the gestures, because in sixth standard, we don't have so much of time to sit with the child, make some actions and say, this is the word for this action or this is the word for this picture. This has to be done in either first class or second or third classes. And still the child has reached sixth class. That is our bad luck actually. And the child can't link the sentences with its meaning. So this is again a problem. The children nowadays, when this CCE method has come, almost all the children are reading it. Like I should say around 40 to 50% of the children are able to read the sentence, but they cannot make meaning of that sentence. This is again a big problem. Yes, Mohammed sir, please, what is your query? Srikanth sir, could you give Mohammed sir permission to speak?
Okay, madam.
He has raised his hand. Sir, are you there?
Sir, please unmute.
Okay. He's got some problem.
Sir, I gave you an option. Unmute, sir.
Oh, sorry, sir. This happened accidentally. Oh. I don't want to ask any query. Okay. Accidentally, it happened.
Okay.
Sorry.
So the child can't link the sentence to the meaning. So that is a problem. So until and unless we say the child can't comprehend certain sentences or words or sounds, then there is no point of the language learning is not happening or the language acquisition is not happening, but we just overlook it and we are bent upon finishing our syllabus. And next is just a few words or parts of sentences. Again, this also is a problem, because when the child comes to the 10th standard or the student reaches the 10th standard, their the student not only has to understand the meaning of the sentences, but he has to make meaning of the sentence. Because at that level, the word says something in an isolation and the word says something in a context. So that sensibility, the child should be able to do that. Then only he can comprehend certain text. Where with all these problems, we still teach the child. Not what the child wants, but what the examination wants or what the teacher wants. Please think about this. Let us go to the next slide. Yes. So, how can a teacher help them? This is again another question. Like I'm already saying that we are losing time and the teacher has to help the child. Because once you reach 10th class, instead of helping them with the answers, it is better to help them in the 6th standard with helping them to read the text. So that when they reach 10th class or later studies, they can read something on their own. Because we will not be there with them forever to help them understand the answer. So how can the teacher address these problems? Like if the child is reading a letter or something or word and not able to sense the meaning, how we can address all these things? Let us see. So the teacher should help, or even this can happen in 10th standard also, because we can't say that the teacher doesn't, that the student doesn't have a stock of words by that time. Fine. So how we can help our children even in the 10th class? Like I can tell you that in each and every child, by the time he reaches 10th standard, he has certain words or certain stock words with him. With that, we can ignite his thinking. So first, you should help him to pick the key words and underline them. Suppose, let me go to the See, you can just see this example here. You can see a text. So the town mouse and the country mouse were cousins. Receiving the invitation from the country mouse, the town mouse packed his bags and caught the next train to the countryside. So the day was bright and sunny, and soon the town mouse began to feel hot in the train. So this is the text which you have in 7th standard. In the same way, there is a text even in the 10th standard also. So certain words like town mouse, country mouse, the child can understand. Because you kept on repeating them right from the day one the class has started, or day one the lesson has started, till the 5th or 6th day. By the time he comes to the reading text, it will be 5th or 6th day. So repeated listening of town mouse, country, invitation, bags, mouse, all these things. Like these becomes the stock words for the child. So the child may not understand the sentence meaning there, but he can recognize that particular words like town mouse or country mouse or like that. So that is how you help the child to pick the key words and underline them. So you ask the child, but don't please read and explain. Allow the child to struggle. Let him pick the words or underline the words which he know in that particular paragraph. And next, you should ask him to make sense between the words understood. So you should tell him what is the relationship between the town mouse and country mouse. Or you can also ask him what is the relationship between town mouse, country mouse, an invitation or bag or packed, all these words. What are the relationship between these words? the child may not tell you the real story what has happened because he can't read the text completely or he can't understand the text, but he can make his own assumptions. Assumptions in the sense is like I listen to some somebody speaking about something and I make my own assumption. Like I think that, oh, these people are discussing about this. Maybe it is related to so-and-so topic. Or maybe they're talking about this person who has come yesterday. So my own assumption, it might be true, it might not be true. But the teacher should have patience to make the child think on that. Then only the thinking process will be developed. So when the thinking process develops, automatically the understanding process also will develop. So when you read the text, it goes over his head. But when you give a chance to the child to understand that or read it on his own and make his own assumptions, though it is wrong, he will start thinking around that. So the child's attraction is built, or the child is with us in the class and we are making the child to learn something on his own. So this will be more productive. And next is create a web between the ideas or parts of sentences. That's what I told. So country mouse and town mouse, we are saying, what is the link between them? Or country mouse, town mouse, and what is it got to do with the bank? Or what is it got to do with the train? Or what is it got to do with the day? So like this, we link up some words. So the child gets, and here, it should not be, what do you understand from this? And what do you think the country mouse and town mouse are doing? Or you can ask such questions to support them. So this will be a good listening input for the children. So this is how you are going to support the child to understand his reading text. But don't explain the text. Please don't explain the text. Question him. Question him till you get your answer. Though it is wrong, encourage him. So now ask him to build up a story on his own with those stop words. So build a story from what do you think is happening with the words you know. So this is what you are going to ask the child. Let him tell his own story, and his story will be different from the other children's story. So every child got his own perception, or every child has got his brain to think. And let them think and tell you a different story, where all these stories are going to be a good listening input for the child. So the day one Jyoti was telling you, or Usha also was telling, if there is good listening and speaking input, the reading will be good and then the writing will be good. So the more you give them the chance to build a story or to say their own story, they will be more happy because they are letting out their ideas. So the anxiety slowly drops. Means the confusion slowly reduces because their story and other story is compared. What are the common things? What are the uncommon things the child is able to sense? So this is how you can help the thought processing of the child. So now then, once the stories, listen to 4 to 5 stories. Maybe we cannot hear all the stories in the class, but try to hear the slow learner story first, and then go to the best student story. So the best student story might be more closer to the text. Then you can interact with them by asking questions on the real idea. Because you already know the real idea, you can question them. So the country mouse and town mouse, both are there. And who is taking the bag? Or who is packing the bag? So some children might say country mouse is packing the bag, or some children might say town mouse is packing the bag. So then you have to again look into the earlier event, what has happened. So who wrote the letter and who has to pack the bag? But don't let the answer. Let the children understand.
What happened?
I think it is muted. Lata Madhavi's audio is muted.
Lata?
Yeah.
I need
madam submission. Madam, I make you co-host.
Please carry
also. Permit me to share my screen also.
Madam, I made you co-host. Madam, you can do it.
Saying that you stopped. Ah, yeah. Fine. Sorry. So where are? Child's level. So how we can help the child learn should be tracked, like which level is he, either in letter level or word level or sentence level or paragraph level. So which where is the child, that should be tracked intensively. Means that is what is CCE, continuous comprehensive evaluation. So as I said, you all the problems, according to the problems we can just track the child.
Hello Lata, again we are losing you. Hello.
If it is muted for everyone, then I am muted. Right. So the child should, the teacher should have patience until the child underline the keywords, because the keywords of every child is different. So we can't just say that a few children are able to underline certain words that they have. Why Srikant, why are you simply muting me?
Not muting madam. Hello?
Yeah, now I'm okay. So and the child should be, so the child should be given his own pace, which we can't do in 10th class, but the teacher is supposed to do in 6th or 7th class, I should tell you. And questioning the child with the keywords, asking him, what do you understand by town mouse, or what do you understand by country mouse? Why do you think the town mouse and country mouse are here? What is happening between them? So even though the child doesn't understand the word or word meaning of the other words in between the in the sentence between those two words, the child can predict some other thing, or even he can also predict the right meaning of that sentence also without reading it. So this should be done by the teacher by questioning, but by not explaining, and listening to the child's assumption though they are not right. So every teacher should have that much of patience that she should be able to listen to the assumption made by the children with the keywords. That means whatever story he is telling, you should be able to hear. So this will help him to improve his speaking skills. So only if the reading part is done properly also, the child will learn all the four skills. So this is how the teacher has to help the child. And next is encouraging the child for every little thing he or she is able to do. Suppose the child is saying the country mouse and the town mouse together are going somewhere. Then also the teacher should encourage. Do you think so? Okay, fine. And go to the next student or the clever student. He's saying like this, that they both are going to the going somewhere. Is it true? Do you agree? Or these type of questions will help the child to know what is the real fact in the story. So the clever child definitely knows that both are not going, only one is going. So when he says the answer, the child will automatically correct. So this type of encouragement or this type of provoking the child to listen to you, to your question and trying to answer, and whatever he has answered, you encourage him, good, you have answered, but go to the, carry the same answer to another student so that he will give you the right answer. So this is how you can help the child to read the text and understand the text also at the same time, which is very, very important for our 10th class unseen text. So let us go for the next slide. Yeah, so this is how, if the child has underlined these words, what I have done, as assuming that the child of that level can do this in our classes. So this is how the teacher has to build town mouse and country mouse and invitation. So who has given invitation to whom? Or did town mouse give invitation to country mouse, or country mouse given invitation to town mouse? So like this kind of questions will help the child to understand that so-and-so person has invited so-and-so person, or so-and-so mouse has invited so-and-so mouse. So after taking the invitation, what happened, we will ask. Then comes the bags. So why do you think the bags, and he said country mouse and town mouse, both of them. So who is really packing the bags? So where the child has to understand which area the question, the teacher should be able to frame a question in such a way that the child understands that particular part of sentence. And after packing the bags, next sentence we can see that train is the word where the child can understand. So how did they go? You can ask one question, or then you can also ask, do you understand anything from this caught and the next? Caught and the next words, do you understand when the teacher asks? Caught word is listened for the first time by the student. The child might say no. So do you think, again you keep asking one or two more questions, the child will catch this word caught from you. But you are not teaching and explaining. When you explain, the child will not learn that word. But when you question, the child will try to listen to it and understand also sometimes. So this should be a regular practice for the teacher to help the child read the unseen text. So maybe I'm too philosophical in doing all these things, but these practices really works in the class, where you need not struggle in class 10 to help the child to do this unseen text question. So this is how you're going to bring linkages between the words that the child can understand or know, or these are called the stock words of the child. And you're bringing a story between the stock words again you're relating that story with the real story in the textbook. So this type of process will help the child understand or read the text. So this is all the theory part what I have been discussing with you all this time. So this practice, if you do in the class, how can the unknown text be read in class 10? Let us see. So the way to read unknown text. So reading the lines is one. Reading between the lines is another one. And reading beyond the lines is another one. So suppose if you are telling, like I have taken a class 7 text just to show you an example so that you can better understand. But in the exam, maybe we will not get 7th or 8th class or 9th class text we cannot take. But we should definitely take the text of unseen or that the child has not read till today. So here if you go through this text, can anyone read this for me please? Quickly. Ismat Saliha. Somebody has raised their hand. Can you read that? No? Saliha, ma'am?
Madam, please unmute.
Anyone? Two participants raised their hand. Anyone can read.
Sudhir sir, please unmute.
Yeah, sir.
Yes.
Raman was born on November 7, 1888 at Tiruchirappalli in Tamil Nadu. His father was a college physics teacher. He was a brilliant student right from the start. When Raman passed his matriculation, his parents were keen to send him abroad for higher studies. But on medical grounds, a British surgeon advised them against it, and Raman stayed in the country to do the MA course at Presidency College in Madras, now called Chennai.
Thank you so much, sir.
My pleasure, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you. So when you take this text, you can see the difference between the meaning of the line. So the first line is so plain. Raman was born on November 7th, 1888. It is just very plain, and the child, even the dull child, if the process is correctly done, he can just look at the words Raman, born, November, and Tiruchirappalli, Tamil Nadu. These things he can make a sense that so-and-so person is born on so-and-so date and in so-and-so place. This is the meaning the child can understand. Any question related to this can be answered very easily because this is going to definitely be a factual question, right? But when you look at this part of the para, like when Raman passed his matriculation, his parents were keen to send him abroad for higher studies. So till here it is plain. It is easily understandable. But when you go to the next line, but on medical grounds, a British surgeon advised them against it, and Raman stayed in the country to do the MA course. So this part of the sentence, actually, which is nowhere related to this family or this person or anything. So here it is beyond the text where the child has to imagine that, or the child should come to know that either Raman was having some problem with his physical health, or whom do you think is having problems with his physical health over there? Anyone? So the British surgeon said on medical grounds he cannot go. So maybe Raman was having certain physical health issues where he cannot go to that. Go abroad. So that is the reason. So here, this meaning, what, or this beyond the text thinking can only happen when the child is practicing the text properly earlier, or else this part of the paragraph can never be addressed. Even for an above average child also, it will be a difficult one. So meaning making between the lines is very, very difficult. And we ask or we pose questions at this part of the text, and we expect the child to get it right. Whereas most of the children, when it is given in MCQs, itself is a confusion. And when the child cannot think beyond the text, again, it will be a problem for him to answer. So this is how the meaning making should be. Yes, Anuradha, you want to say something? So this should be a practice from years together to address this issue. So the meaning between the lines should be understood by the child when he can think beyond the text. So just catch my point. The child should be able to think beyond the text to understand the meaning between the lines. So this is a very difficult thing for the child to happen, or his cognitive process, if it is not trained properly, his cognitive process will never ever support this text, not even in 10th class, but even when he reaches to the highest level of education, he will not be able to do this. So this problem should be addressed right from the beginning, maybe from second or third class, when he starts sensing the text. And the practice should be vigorous in the years of class 6, 7 and 8. So that when the child comes to 9th standard and 10th standard, he is able to think properly. He is able to understand the text and make meaning out of the text, which we lack in our classrooms. So next, what type of unseen texts we look at? Just have a look at this text. You can read it at your own pace, everyone. And just, I will come to the parts where I have highlighted them. So when you look at the whole text, you can see the other all sentences are simple and clear, most of them. But certain sentences, see here, I scratched my first Beatles record. Tactfully, I don't mention that I had bought the record she's listening to before she was born. So what do you mean by this? Is again a question for the child, because I scratched my first Beatles record. Here, scratched is a word which is actually used contextually in a different way, where the scratch comes isolated way in a different way. When you people teach meanings and words and then go to sentences, this type of confusion we are embedding into the child's brain. So the scratch card is your debit card, which he is scratching for buying a Beatles record. And you should tell your children that this sentence meaning lies in the next sentence. That means tactfully, I don't mention that I had bought the records. So he's saying the bought word reflects the scratch word. That means there is a link between the scratch and the bought. So this linkages, if the child is able to make, then you are a very successful and very elegant teacher who has 100% supported your children to read the text. So this type of texts, though it looks very simple, it has got very in-depth meaning into it. So your question paper setter, when he is doing the question paper, he only thinks taking certain sentences and making a question out of it, but he will never think how far your child can understand it. So you should teach these techniques that how certain sentences meaning lies in the next sentence also. That is called reading in between the lines, or reading the lines and then reading in between the lines also. So this type of texts, this looks simple, but it is very in-depth meaning. And you can't just expect a 10th standard child to take a very light text and say the orange is orange in color and it is sour to taste. So the fruit seller has bought a basket of oranges. This is not going to be your unseen text in the exam. Definitely not. I really feel bad for the children. When the teacher teaches, she doesn't take any precautions to take care of all these problems. But when the question paper is prepared, the teacher feels that it should be tough and it should be easy also. So you make 40% of the questions to be easy and 60% of the questions to be above average, where you're not trained that even an above average child to address the above average questions. So think about it, my teachers. So this is another text I would like to bring before you, where this text, you can see what is the difference between this text and the other text, what we have just read now. Can anybody tell? You can give your own ideas actually. Srikant sir, please okkasari unmute cheyandi, vallu em anukuntunnaro kuda em ardhamu
ledhu. Madam, okkasari hand raise cheyamanu madam evarunanna.
Yeah, yeah, please raise your hands who would like to answer this. Because if you don't respond, I don't know how far I can get you all understand. Yes, Reena.
Madam, please unmute.
Yeah, Reena, unmute yourself and speak.
Madam, I give you an option. Unmute, madam, please.
Left side, there is a mic, Reena, unmute. Okay. Okay,
ma'am. Ma'am, good evening.
Lata, yeah, please go ahead, Reena.
Good evening, madam.
Yeah, Reena, tell me the difference between the
text. Yeah, yeah, nothing but like how to make more easier way to like understand the concept of reading. And just understanding the text by themselves, the more easier way. You just let us know. Some words are very hard to understand to the students. So what can we do in that manner?
What will
how
you?
How to make more? Yeah, got my point, ma'am. That's what my.
What would you like to do?
Myself.
Yeah.
That's what I am. I want to make more easier to understand the text to them.
Question
then
there.
What?
Questionnaire. Okay, what, you want to make the text easy, question them more. Right.
Okay.
So I'm sorry. I couldn't get my answer, but anyway, I would like to disclose it. So you see complex sentences in this. Where is my country? Though it is related to the topic what we have done already, we have done in the class, like plea for India and all. But still, the sentences are too complex, like too big. So for the child to understand this sort of text in an unseen passage would be really difficult for our 10th class students. So definitely when the examiner, what should the paper setter do? Let us see now. So care to be taken while setting exam papers. So first thing is the text should not be selected with philosophical background. So the philosophy, like how this can be more of beyond thinking, should not be taken. One or two ideas can be taken beyond the text thinking. And next one is, see that the words in the text are in the child's experiential order orbit. So definitely the text, whoever is the exam paper setter, should take a precaution that the words in the text are within the experiential orbit of the child. Next, selected text that had an extreme impact on the public. That means recently some issues might have happened, and select positive issues. Don't select negative issues like accidents or somebody's murder or criminal cases. Please don't go to that sort of text, though it is simple. So you should select in such a way that the public has spoken about it much. So that would be easier for the child to answer. And next is, meanings of certain new words can be given if necessary. Like when you're selecting the text, the word that child must, the whole text is good, but 2 to 3 words in the text are very difficult. Then you can give the meaning of that text in the below the passage. Then avoid with more of complexity. So that is what. So avoid text with more of complexity. Try to select simple sentences, text with in-depth meaning. That's what I was showing you, the like Raman. So there should be some factual things. There should be some in-depth thinking also when you're selecting that particular passage or paragraph. Text may be selected on the themes dealt in the textbooks. So it is better to go for the themes that are already dealt in our textbook, like family, friendship, historic places or food, or some topics that we have already done in our textbooks. So this is how we go with the reading text. And as Reena told, I think I have given you the easiest way of doing things, like connecting, finding out the keywords and connecting the keywords and making stories, helping the child to make stories with the keywords is the important process. If the teacher takes care of that, the child will be definitely able to read the text. And there are no shortcuts to learn something in class 10. This should be practiced right from the beginning. And if not happened in the primary classes, at least from the 6th class, it should be practiced. Then only the child will be able to answer this part of the exam. So with this, I will conclude. Any queries from your side, you can please ask.
Madam, submission, madam. One more participant raised their hand, madam.
Yes, sir. Please give them, sir. I'll take only 2 minutes more, Jyoti. Let us listen to 1 or 2 questions and then I'll hand it over to you.
Madam Amrita, madam, please unmute. Madam, please, I give you an option. Please unmute, madam.
Amrita madam, please unmute your microphone and please talk. Please ask your query.
Okay, madam.
Anybody else?
Madam Amrita madam, please proceed, madam.
నా క్వశ్చన్ ఎక్కడ అడగాలి?
యు కెన్ స్పీక్ మేడం, యు కెన్ ఆస్క్, యు ఆర్ ఆడిబుల్.
ఇప్పుడు మాట్లాడొచ్చా?
యు టాక్ మేడం, యు టాక్ అమృత మేడం, యు టాక్.
యా మేడం, స్టిల్ ఐ డిడ్ంట్ హియర్ ద వాయిస్ మేడం, బికాస్ మై ఫోన్ హాడ్ గివెన్ సమ్ ట్రబుల్. Listen what Lata madam had taught still. So after listening the madam's, I will ask you question, madam.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, madam.
Anybody else? Any queries? That's it.
Madam, no one responding, ma'am. Shall I?
Yes, sir. Okay. Okay, then I would like to conclude my session. Over to you, Jyoti.
Over to Usha, madam.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, sorry.
Thank you, madam.
If Usha is the madam. Class, that's what I was asking. Usha is taking the class. Over to you, Usha.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. We also learned many new things about the reading the text today.
Usha, I'm waiting for your completion of session.
Okay.
Just joking.
As possible.
Just joking.
Okay. Srikant sir.
Madam.
My slides are ready, I hope.
Ready, madam.
Okay. Okay, good evening all. We are coming step by step and all everything. Day before yesterday, we discussed classroom transaction process. After the classroom transaction process, it is an assessment. And madam has already given some important things about unseen passages, unseen reading text. So we'll see the very important thing in our total complete school curriculum, that is assessment. Srikant sir, my slides. So today's our topic is assessment. Next one, sir. Second one. So if you see, what is an assessment? Assessment is a process of gathering information from multiple and diverse sources in order to develop a deep understanding of what students know, what they understand, what they can do with their knowledge as a result of their educational experiences. So to understand what the child, we can say what the child know, KWL, what he knows, what he wants to know, and what he learned, on what are the areas of improvement. To know the student throughout the school curriculum, we need what is called an assessment. So because assessment helps teachers try to improve the student's path towards learning. Assessment is not an activity distinct from learning. It is a part of learning process. Learning is facilitated through, if we know that in the classroom transaction process, learning is facilitated through individual responses, paired discussions, group discussions, etc. So that means assessment takes place at these three levels in the classroom transaction process. So assessment also helps learners compare their strengths and weaknesses and make modifications in their learning. That means that assessment also gives not only the teachers, even the learners also, to improve themselves in the future classes. So that's why we need an assessment. Why we need to discuss? Because earlier we used to hear the word called evaluation. After the commencement of CCE, continuous comprehensive evaluation, we come across this word assessment. So that's why we need to know what is an assessment. Now we'll see what is the difference between assessment and evaluation. Srikant sir, next slide, please. So if you come across these are the differences between evaluation, assessment and evaluation. Assessment, it tests how learning is processing, how the learning in the classroom transaction process or during the assessment, formative assessment, that comes the last point, how the learning is processing. So here we should know that assessment is a systematic process to measure the knowledge, the skills, the attitudes and beliefs of the learners. Whereas if you go to the evaluation tests what has been learned. That means evaluation takes place at the end, whereas assessment is throughout the learning process. If you go to the second one, it is a diagnostic. It is a diagnostic. That means it identifies the areas of improvements. It gives scope to find the areas or the skills to be improved. How? Teacher has to plan according to the assessment. Teacher has to plan to improve the skills of the students. That's why it is called diagnostic. Whereas if you go to evaluation, sir, the same slide. If you go to the evaluation, it is called judgmental because it arrives at, it concentrates on overall score. That means it focuses on grades. If you go to assessment, once again, it is process oriented, whereas evaluation is product oriented. If you go to assessment, once again, it is conducted during the learning process, whereas evaluation is held at the end of the learning process. That is as a final review to judge the quality of the instruction. Fifth point, if you go, assessment helps students to learn from each other, because we have already discussed just now that individual activities, group activities, pair activities, everything goes on during the assessment process. So it helps the children to learn during the learning process. If you go to evaluation, it makes the students compete with each other because it concentrates on the final product. So we call assessment as formative and evaluation as summative. So next one. Now the question is why assessment is needed. It is needed because our total teaching format has been changed to CCE, that is Continuous Comprehensive Evaluation. It stresses that language learning is a continuous process. Moreover, if you see SCF 2011, NCF 2005, and RT 2009 have emphasized the importance of implementing CCE. That means they proposed that continuous comprehensive assessment should be taken place at all stages of learning. So CCE is an ongoing process and it has become the integral part of the lesson. And further, assessment is needed because the thrust is on the formative aspects of learning instead of relying on a single paper pencil test at the end of the academic year. It concentrates on formative aspects, attitudes, skills, beliefs, knowledge, everything of the learner. So all the assessments have to take place in a non-threatening atmosphere. According to these three, it should be CCE said that all the assessments have to take place in a non-threatening atmosphere without causing any burden on the learner. So at this place, to fulfill the demands or the what the proposals needed for CCE, here assessment meets all the demands of CCE. It fulfills the ongoing process of CCE, which has become the integral part of the lesson. Assessment process identifies learning process of the progress of the students. We just now discussed, it gives continuous feedback to the teacher and also feedback to the learners, and it gives the teachers helps the teachers in the progress of the students. Assessment recognizes and encourages the specific abilities of the students because it also includes curricular and also co-curricular activities of the student. Okay, next one. So based on this assessment, we have different types of assessment, two types, that is formative assessment and summative assessment. Please don't say the slide is very small, you can zoom it. So it is said that if you take the first picture, it said that when the chef tastes the soup, it is formative assessment. When the guest tastes the soup, it is summative assessment. Okay, so this difference we need to know, because the chef, he himself prepares. So how the soup tastes? When others taste the soup, how does it taste? So that is called the summative. Coming to the first one, it takes throughout, but summative takes at the end. If you go to this table, the difference between formative assessment and summative assessment. Formative assessment goal is to monitor students' learning, to provide ongoing feedback that can be used by instructor to improve their teaching and also by students to improve their learning. It is giving feedback not only to the teacher, not only to the students, but also to the teacher. Whereas if you go to summative assessment, the goal of summative assessment to evaluate students' learning at the end of an instructional unit by comparing it against some standard of benchmark. We have the benchmark, how to award the marks and everything at the weightage table. Further, formative assessment, evaluation takes place during the throughout the learning process. But in the summative assessment, evaluation takes place after the completion of the course. In formative assessment, teacher monitors the learning process, whereas here we are concentrating on assigning the grades. In formative assessment, the purpose is to improve students' learning. In summative, the purpose is to evaluate students' achievements. Informative evaluation includes little content areas. This is very important. Underline the word little. Little content areas. But in summative assessment, evaluation includes complete chapters or the major content areas. Formative assessment considers evaluation as a process, whereas summative assessment considers evaluation as a product. So this is the difference between formative assessment and summative assessment. So next one. So based on this, our CCE proposed four formative tools. That is formative. So we are discussing now very important part of this training now. Formative assessment tools, marks, grades, guidelines, etc. for our Telangana schools. So the four tools of formative assessment are read and reflect, written work, project works, and SWIP test. So the next one.
Madam, submission, madam, a few participants are unable to hear your voice, madam. So you please make sure that speak loudly, madam.
Loudly? Okay, sir. Ma'am. Okay, okay. Is it clear now, sir? Okay.
Okay. Okay, sir. Okay, ma'am.
So the four formative tools are read and reflect, written works, project works, and SLIP test. So the next one, sir. Okay. So coming to the first one, read and reflect. Just now we discussed here. Madam also concentrated, Lata Madhi madam concentrated on reading, especially on the reading concept. So reading, we know that reading is one of the, keep the same slide. Srikant sir, let the same slide be there till I inform you, please. Reading is the next one, sir. This one. Reading is one of the major inputs for language development. So we need to concentrate on, if madam said, if the reading happens properly, so language acquisition also happens properly. So reading takes a very major role in our classroom transaction process. Coming to as a formative tool about read and reflect, here there are certain suggestions for the teacher. The teacher is suggested to provide reading materials such as library books, magazines, articles, newspapers, etc. to the learners. That means other than the textbook. It doesn't mean that we should concentrate only on the storybooks. No. Any other material other than the textbook can be provided to the students. Any beautiful articles or the wonderful articles or interesting articles, useful articles from the magazines or from the newspapers also can be selected to the children for this tool. The learner should read. The teacher will ask the learner read the reading material and write the reflections in their notebooks. Here I mention here that children need to maintain two separate notebooks. In one notebook they are writing read and reflect, SLIP test and project work, and one more notebook for written works, which takes care of in the classroom transaction process. So the children also here in the read and reflect also are asked to present their reading experience orally without looking at the notebook before the class. That means it consists of both oral and written part in the read and reflect part. Why we need this read and reflect? Just now madam has said, reading is complete when it happens reading the lines, reading between the lines, and reading beyond the lines. So that's why this is very important part, read and also reflect. So here, if you go to the structure, here many are at confusion, I think. Coming to the structure, when the child is writing read and reflect in the notebooks, so the format can be, or sometimes you can change name of the story of or topic, if you are giving a story or a topic. Source, from there that has been taken. If any publication of that storybook, publication and year of the storybook is present there, that also should be mentioned. Name of the writer, if any, if it is a story, we'll have the name of the writer. Characters involved, this is concerned to the story. In the story, if it is a story, we have the characters.
we are writing the summary, or you can call it as a gist. If it is an article or the newspaper article or any magazine article, you can call it as a gist. And finally, my reflection or my opinion, here it is a reflection or it is a opinion of the child, what he has understood, how he is connected to the reading material that is mentioned here in the my reflection. Sir, somebody, Prabhakar sir raised the hand. Does he has any query?
Madam, shall I unmute them?
Yes, sir. Prabhakar sir.
Hello.
Prabhakar sir.
Yes, madam. Is it audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Ma'am, good evening, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
Regarding read and reflection, I need one clarification, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
Madam, all of us know that for reading and reflect, we should give the text apart from textbook. Is it, ma'am?
Yes, sir.
But some of the teachers are giving some topics from the textbook and asking the children to read and reflect from the textbook itself. And I told many teachers in regarding complex meetings that it is not correct.
Yes, sir.
But ma'am.
It should be other than the textbook, sir.
Yes, ma'am. I told them many times that read and reflection should not be given from the textbook. But they said that.
If the teachers are not getting any other material other than the textbooks, suppose the child is of seventh class, the teacher can select the textbook of eighth class. In my opinion, listening passages or any good story or any good article from the higher classes. Then which will be up to the level of the seventh class standard students, so they select, but not from the same class. If the child is in the seventh class, the teacher cannot give the material from the same class textbook.
Okay.
The teacher can go to the eighth class or ninth class or tenth class. The teacher should select such material which is up to the level of the seventh class standard students. Then only that can be given. But I think, sir, it will not be a problem to collect the reading materials other than the textbooks, because we'll have the school library books, or we'll have if you go to children's magazines, we have many magazines, children magazines. We get very beautiful articles from the newspapers also.
Yes, ma'am.
Up to whatever is happening now also, if the teacher thinks that this should be known to the children, what is happening in the society at present, or the important events happening in by our government, if such articles are there, such articles also can be selected from the newspaper, and those also can be given to the students.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, sir. Am I clear, sir?
Yes, clear, ma'am. But many of the I heard that many of the teachers are giving, and I myself faced that. That's what I'm asking regarding this topic. So, and even if you give from a lower class also, the same topics will be repeated in higher classes, ma'am. For example, whatever the discourse it may be, they are available in all the classes sequentially.
Yes, that's what, sir.
They are asking to write essay writing, take from any lower class and read and reflect. But I said them, it's not correct.
No, that's why this structure is given, sir. We come across that they're just writing a paragraph, they're just writing summary only. But they need to write their reflection also. That's why this structure.
And this regarding the structure this also, many teachers have their different opinions, madam. Please inform all the teachers, those are listening to this topic. I hope that all the teachers are listening. Mm-hmm. And those are coming for even valuation also for internal marks, please instruct them that they should follow this structure. Because mm-hmm. those who are coming, they have their own different ideas and opinions.
Yes, sir. That's why the structure is given, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay, this is about, and coming to the marks, assessment indicators for read and reflect. Read and reflect here, oral and written take 5 marks each. The teacher should maintain the cumulative record for recording individual performances. For oral discourses, or the oral one, teachers diary and everything will be the
proof, and for written they are writing in the notebook, and so how to consolidate we'll see in the next one. So this is about read and reflect, and when going through for oral and written, the teacher need to follow certain indicators. When it comes to oral, like stating the context, sequence of ideas, well formed sentences, proper articulation, these will be the assessment indicators for oral performance. And for written performances, the teacher can take into account the indicators like stating the context, sequencing, well formedness, personal opinion, that is in my reflection, conventions of writing and spellings. They need to write at least 100 to 120 words about that is my reflection. So this is about read and reflect. Coming to the next one, that is written works. Written works, here also we find major things in the what even I have found in the coming to the written works. It is nothing but the notebook. I said written work is nothing but it is the notebooks of the children. The written works here include, if you just go through the slide here, the written works include the discourses written individually as part of classroom process. See, after in the during the classroom transaction process, after in the reading, in the post reading part, the teacher is giving the written discourse after every chunk or after every slot, and the teacher is brainstorming the child how to write in the form of questions, and the teacher is giving the discourse. And day before yesterday in the classroom transaction process, we discussed that there will be individual presentation, there will be group presentation, and there will be teacher's presentation. All these versions should be there in the notebooks. And the next point is the answers to the analytical questions assigned to the learners as homework. We said that at the scaffolded reading or extrapolating the text, the teacher will give analytical questions so such that the children will understand the concept of the reading passage between the lines and beyond the lines. So these analytical questions are given as a homework, and the children are supposed to write the answers and discuss the answers later in the classroom. These should be there in the notebook. And apart from this, the textual exercises, grammar and vocabulary and study skills, whatever other written work is given in the textbook, though that should be presented in the notebook. So these are something called the written work. So not that, so I have seen personally that they are just simply writing the question answers and everything from the question bank, and that is called a homework. So when I went to some schools, or maybe my school only, I was astonished listening to when I asked them to open your notebooks. They said, is it the classwork notebook or homework notebook? No. No classwork, no homework. Only one book it will be there. It is itself is a rough notebook. Itself is a classwork. Itself is a homework. That is the proof that the children are doing the work. They are trying to improve themselves in the classroom transaction process. That notebook itself is the proof. So see that these things will be there. The discourse is written, the answers to the analytical questions, and the textual exercises. This is considered under written work. And the teachers here have to ensure that the children are writing individually and not by copying. So during the duration of formative, there are two units. We are awarding 10 marks each and consolidate them to 5 marks. So that if you are taking two units in the formative period, you can give the 10 marks out of 10 marks, and you can consolidate, that is 20 by 2, you get the consolidation marks of 5 marks. So when we are giving the discourse, Madam Jyoti Madam is going to take the next session about the discourses also. So teacher, in the written work, when teacher is giving the either the oral discourse or the written discourse, teacher has to concentrate on the indicators or the parameters of the various discourses. So this is about the written work. Srikanth sir, next slide. The very, very, very important thing, that is the project work. So we know that every unit has the project. Every unit contains a project work to be carried out by the students. because these projects are thematically related. Every unit has a project. Why we need the project work? Projects help the students to evolve themselves as independent users of language. They provide platform for integrating language skills because they can undergo various study skills during their individual work, pair work, and group work. And also, project work involves higher order thinking skills. Here in the project work, the learners have to explore the theme of the project by various things like collecting the data, consolidating it using different formats, writing reports on them, and making presentations in the whole class. So that means project work takes place at these levels like brainstorming, that is the nature of the project, collecting the data, consolidating the data and deciding the structure of the report and analyzing it, writing the report and presenting the report. Coming to the brainstorming, we have to brainstorm on the nature of the project work and evolve the tools, how they are carrying out the project. That is called the tool or method required for carrying out the work. So here what the teacher will do is, again, teacher will interact with the children on the project task. Teacher will brainstorm the children's mind and she'll prepare the mind maps or different graphic organizers, which we have separate session on Monday, different types of graphic organizers. Brainstorming is done on the information to be collected, because as such we cannot write, do this project and leave the children. The children cannot do. So to give them some idea in the form of questions, the teacher will put different questions to brainstorm, to give the different exploration thinking or the reasoning or the imagination to the child. Teacher will throw light on what the information to be collected, what the tools required, what are the sources required, what type of work to be done, when they should do individual work, when they should do pair work, when they should do the group work, and what are the format for the consolidation, how they should analyze the consolidated data, and how they should write the report. So this is done during the brainstorming. And after brainstorming, let the children decide the tools individually, whether they are doing it the group work or pair work, whether it is a questionnaire method or survey method, let the children decide. Let them share in groups, reaching at the, that is, once the individual collected the tools or collected the data, let them share the data in groups and let them sit together and do the work. So we can expect here that all the children will have the good idea about the nature of the product by the end of brainstorming. They'll have the clear idea how they have to do the project work. That is how it is to be carried out. And coming to the next one, collection of data. So using the tools, they will collect the data. They'll collect the data. Once the data is collected, we need to go for classroom process for consolidating the data. This is to be followed by brainstorming on the structure of the report. At the consolidation of the data and deciding the structure, let the children sit in groups and share what they have collected. They have to record the data using the formats. So again, they have to work together on the report, how to write the report. Here also the teacher can interact. That is very, very important. Teacher has to monitor throughout the project. Teacher is not directly giving anything, but teacher is monitoring and interacting with the children wherever necessary. So, coming to the structure of the project work. Name of the project, they're writing this way in the notebooks. Name of the project or title of the project. Purpose of the project, that is otherwise aim, we say. Tools or methods for data collection. Data collection and analysis, that is consolidated. And writing the report. This is a written form. And coming to the presentation, that is the oral form, oral presentation. And we have the assessment indicators here for the project work. 10 marks are awarded. The 10 marks are divided into 7 plus 3, 7 marks for written work
and 3 marks for presentation, that is orally. Out of 7 marks, 2 marks are for preparation of tools, 2 marks are for collection of data and analysis, that is consolidated data and analysis. For report writing, report presentation, that is a 3 marks, and for oral presentation, that is a 3 marks. In the oral presentation, the child will before the class tell how they have collected, how he has collected the data, how he has written the report, how they have consolidated and all. Here the project work, at sometimes it is individual work and also it is a group work. The teacher has to take care of all these things while awarding the marks. So this is something about the project work. So there are a few confusions about the marks. This is how we award the marks, whatever may be the structure of the project, whatever they are writing, but we are awarding the marks for preparation of tools. This will be there even in their notebooks. Classwork notebooks also will be there when it is coming to the preparation of tools and collection of data. This will be there even in their individual notebooks will be there. So this is something about the project work. Next slide. Coming to the slip test, here also I think we come across many doubts or many question marks and all. The very first important thing is first we'll discuss only the components which are present on the slide. Slip test should be conducted in this way. We have to concentrate while we are conducting the slip test. Our question paper should be like this. 20 marks are for slip test. If you go to read and reflect, it is for 10 marks. That is the next slide we are saying. Slip test is conducted for 20 marks. In that 20 marks, these two ways you can go, either the first one or the second one. Comprehension passage, 5 marks. Either you take the seen passage or unseen passage, that is left to you. Vocabulary and grammar, 5 marks. Discourse, 10 marks, because it is a major discourse. Or comprehension passage, 5 marks. Grammar, 5 marks. Vocabulary, 5 marks. Discourse, 5 marks, if you are selecting the minor discourse. So this should be compulsorily followed. And one more very important thing here is that when we are framing the question for a slip test, please, we need to frame the question paper of the slip test same as we are getting the questions in these areas in the summative question paper. Please give the same way the questions, that is everything in the form of the passages, not any individual. Write the opposite to these words, giving the 5 words and giving the space, fill in the blank beside. No, frame the questions in the form of the passages only, because we have the passages only in the summative evaluation. So this is about the components. Some more very important things about the slip test is, slip test is more or less similar to summative assessment, but it is still different from summative assessment. Like, there is no prior notice for conducting the slip test. It is done in a limited time, in the regular period of 40 minutes. There are only limited number of tasks, as we discussed, you know. Here, what we can do is the discourses that have been done in the formative period also consider for the slip test. You can consider those discourses which are written also during the formative period. It depends on you. There is no printed question paper. It depends on the teacher or as the situation demands. The teacher can write the task on the chart and display it or write the questions on the blackboard. There should be one discourse, one passage for reading comprehension, one item from grammar and vocabulary. Thus, in the slip test, we should cover the discourses such that the students are preparing for summative tests. We are selecting such discourses. The teacher should record the slip test marks in the register and should consolidate the marks during every formative period. And we need to assess the written performance and also compulsorily give the positive feedback to the learners, because it is a formative assessment where we are preparing the children for summative evaluation or summative assessment. While in the slip test, we are awarding the marks based on the indicators that are included in the learning outcomes or academic standards under written discourses. We are recording anyway the marks in cumulative record. So here, once again, in the slide, if you see, this is the way we have to award marks in the slip test. So this is something about the slip test. Sir, next one. Srikant, sir, next slide. So these are the formative tools. Read and reflect, we are conducting 10 to 10 marks. Written work, we are conducting to 10 marks. Project work, we are conducting to 10 marks. Slip test, we are conducting to 20 marks. Finally, we are consolidating all these marks to 5, 5, 5, 5. Totally, and it comes to every formative, FA1, FA2, FA3, FA4, all this formative comes to 20 marks. And finally, we are consolidating again all the four formative assessment, FA1, FA2, FA3, and FA4 divided by 4 at the end. When we have to combine or add these marks to the summative assessment mark that we are doing at the end. So next one. So regarding summative assessment, we know very well about the summative paper. Anyway,
consolidate.
That's why I'm going quickly. If you go to 6th to 8th classes, we have section A, B, C, and D. Reading comprehension, vocabulary and grammar, conventions of writing and creative writing, that is discourses, major and also minor. When you come to 9th and 10th classes, we have reading comprehension, section B, grammar and vocabulary, and section C, creative writing, that is major and minor discourses. Sir, next one. So these are the grading 4 marks we get anyway in the schools also. Next one, sir. Sir, next slide. This is a grading 4 marks. So if you go to except Hindi, we'll get our subject there. 50 marks are there, 80 marks and also 100 marks. So next one. So this is a weightage table for class 6 to 8. Written, they are writing 70 only, our question paper. We are adding, depending on the classroom transaction process, we are adding 10 marks here and 20 marks formative assessment marks are added. So the next one. So the next one. Next slide. So this is a weightage table for classes 9th and 10th. 40 paper 1 and 40 marks for paper 2, total 80 marks. They are writing in the summative assessment. The last slide, sir. Next one, sir. Next one.
Finished, ma'am. Finished, ma'am.
This you keep here only. So here, this is my last slide today. But I want to conclude with a small thing that. So a truly professional teacher needs to be patient, innovative, that is explorative. And teacher has to assess his or her students' progress in every period, in each class, and give proper positive feedback to each and every student so that the language acquisition takes place in a smooth, natural, and non-conscious manner, and as CCE says, non-threatening manner. So this is the end of my session. Thank you, one and all. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you so much for a wonderful presentation, madam.
Thank you, ma'am.
Shall I start?
Yeah, ma'am. You start, ma'am.
Thank you. So I just want to throw some light on the reading before discourses. Is it audible? Is it audible? Usha?
Audible, audible.
Okay, right.
Okay.
Okay. See, reading is a vital skill, as it was discussed in the first session by Madam, Lata Madam. And it in turn motivates speaking and writing skill in normal contexts. So reading is, here reading, I mean seen and unseen text. I just want to add some more points. Reading is a basically meaning making process, and it gives sense, we all know, to a given text. Here it includes recognition of shapes, recognition of shape of letters at a lower level, graphophonemic knowledge, like recognizing letters, understanding the sound, relationship and spelling pattern, the direction of text, recognition of vocabulary, morphemes, like minimal meaningful language units, syntax, all these things. And while reading, the learner has to make use of visual and phonological and semantic use in an integrated manner. This is very essential. Relate the previous knowledge, experience of the world, the topic, to construct the meaning and the text that is before him. So to develop this reading skill at an initial stage, reading variety texts aloud regularly, continuous reading of variety of texts. That's why children are to be provided with number of English small moral stories or sub stories which they enjoy, colorful story books, and regularly to become acquainted with with the conventions of print and text. See, they have to coordinate it. And at a later stage, at a later higher level, skimming of text for global information. For example, if a larger text is given, if a text which contain higher level of meaning, skimming, scanning a text for a specific information, especially from tables, or inferring implicit meaning in a given text, or understanding the writer's intention. So this is where comes in usually in our 10th class. So what are the different few things that you can do? Like, you can create print rich environment for the children at the school, and ask them to even at home, you can encourage them. This is where you can do this innovative practice of using ICT, yesterday's class. Reading can be tremendously improved by using ICT. It is the best way. By using ICT, you can do it. Yesterday it was cleared how you can do. And we have to encourage a wide variety of books and reading material for the children. Newspapers, magazines, storybooks, websites, and other literature and all. And providing a reading corner in a classroom. This is also, that's what, when the team comes at the state level or the national level or district level, it's very important that we have, as English teachers, we have to provide a reading corner in a classroom. So it can be a very, very powerful way to get them excited about stories and expose them to text more advanced than they are able to read themselves, isn't it? So I'm so question tags sometimes come, I do in a wrong way, I'm sorry. So here, you can help children to get them more excited about those stories. Telling stories is also best way. Reading stories, telling them with all gestures and body language will go a long way in promoting reading skills among them. Discuss the story with children and forget their mistakes. See, this is also very important. And taking them to library, if you have a library, explore it. There are some myths also, reading myths. Yes, there are some reading myths. Let us see. See, though reading, it might seem to be very difficult for some people, but it isn't an impossible task to master the skill. This we have to remember. Reading is a process where the brain, it look at the symbols on the page, and your mind sees the patterns of characters and understands and try to understand the meaning in them, isn't it? So this is our misconception. It is our misconception to think that we can never read English like native readers, as we are non-native speakers of English. Our Guruji, like our father of CC, Dr. Anandan, once in his initial training programs at Hyderabad SCRT, he told one, I think but Hanmantrao sir also was there with me in that training program, first platform, I think. So there, he told one day, a Tamilian says, pronounce a word simply. He says, simply. And we say, we can't judge him by his pronunciation, it's wrong. Because he, it is correct in his local dialect. And he says,
MTI, we are now
the, sir?
MTI, mother tongue influence, impact.
Yeah. So this is what we have to remember. And it's not wrong. Essay English, he said. So that's what I just want to add it. And is it right way? So some doubts are kept going on. There are some doubts which keep coming to our mind regularly. Is this the right way to read? Am I able to pronounce this word properly or not? Am I following the proper pause and pace of reading? So these are the questions. Making effort to develop our language capabilities and cognitive skills together will essentially make one smarter. So we have to make an attempt. And once in this intimidating thought about reading, it vanishes, it goes away from child's brain, English will become, soon it will become very easier for them. And some improving reading skills, some tips I just want to share. Find something to read. Example, try to read children's books, newspaper articles, short stories in the initial stages. Select the books depending on children reading level. Next, schedule a time to read. Do this. So this can be judged by the teacher in their classroom. I can read a book that will capture. Children can read a book which will capture their own interest. Like usually colorful books. And another strategy is they have to read every page carefully. Don't rush through. They shouldn't rush through. Read as much as you are able to do. Reread the material for better understanding in the initial stages. Rereading the material for better understanding. Next, use contextual clues to find out the meanings. This is what we do in the second stage of reading process. And a 1 minute reading passage, some technique, like take a stopwatch to start at the beginning of reading and stop upon completion. Record your reading on your mobile or any other electronic device and just listen to your reading. And count the mispronounced or skipped words along with the words that have been switched in order. Word substitutions. So all these can be checked. This will help you to catch a mistake, self-correct. This is where you have to go for ICT. Repeat a word or line as long as it is correctly read. Or you can hear to that particular word on a voice dictionary available. ICT. Late night, I was just thinking how ICT can be incorporated. And testing your comprehension. This we are doing through MCQs, simple MCQs. Using retelling is another strategy. Retelling, this is a strategy to improve comprehension of reading material. After reading a story, article, you have to summarize it. What it was about your what it was with your colleagues or friends. This also gives you a chance to use new vocabulary words to better understand the meaning. Next, read together. Reading a text with a partner. It also improves fluency and helps you to expand your vocabulary. Another important strategy, critical predictions. I think you can understand. Read a part of the story or reading text, then stop at a turning point and try to predict the story future. So these are some just points I just wanted to add. Now I just come to my topic today. I want to just
all are well versed with discourses that we have in our syllabus, right from class 6 to 10. And today we'll just try to look into these different discourses. As we all know, the major activity of post-reading session is construction of a discourse by learners. And by virtue of inputs received through listening and reading, or sometimes writing also, they are in a position to take up a task which demands them to construct a specific discourse. And for a very fruitful construction of discourse, the facilitator or the teacher, we have to focus on three important areas: interaction for brainstorming to sensitize the learners towards the features or the content of the discourse, helping the learners to support them and securing them with obstacles they are facing during the, like while writing the discourse, and analyzing the discourse produced by the learners by the theme, content and features. Now first slide, Srikanth. Hello, is it audible? Hello.
Yes, yes.
Okay. So the first one, narrative. It's not. There are some errors during typing errors. Please bear with it. Narrative. The basic purpose of narrative is to entertain, to gain and hold a reader's interest. And we all know, however, narratives can also be written to teach or inform or change attitudes or social opinions. We have different narratives like different types of narratives: imaginary, factual. Combine both, like imaginary you may include fairy stories, mysteries, science fiction, romances, horror stories, adventures, some legends, historical narratives. All these different types of narratives are there. And we come to the features of narrative. Characters with dialogues are included in a narrative. Characters with a defined personalities or identities are shown, and a descriptive language to create images in the reader's mind to enhance the story or whatever it is. It might be a story or something, or a mystery or some suspense or a horror story, anything. So that can be enhanced with a descriptive language. And here what are the dialogues often included? The tense may change into present or future. Here spelling mistakes are there. And introduction in which the characters. Please, 1 minute. Excuse me. So introduction in which the characters are setting and the time of story are established, usually answers for questions like who, when, where. Another thing, complication or a problem usually involves main characters after mirroring complication in real life. In every narrative, usually in narratives, there are some problems. And a resolution. There need to be resolution or complication. Maybe happily or unhappily, for creating some suspense and interest to the reader, we do all these are to be embedded in a narrative. And in narrative, the different areas, stages are the first plot, next we have the setting,
characterization, structure, and the theme. Here, structure means here how the story has begun and the problem, and solving of that, resolution of that problem. So these are the five major areas that we have to cover in the narrative. The language. Language usually used in a narrative must have a lot of action verbs. For example, the old woman was in her way. The old woman barred his path. Narrative can be written either in first person or third person. Usually must be in past tense. Connectives, linking words must be used. Specific nouns, for example, oak as opposed to tree, specific nouns. Next, active nouns, use of senses. This must be involved while writing a narrative. And we all have our handbook and ICT. So explore with help of children and try to, we all can try to construct, give opportunity for the children to construct good narratives. Next one is description. Usually, people get involved in certain situations when they have to talk about others. So sometimes they may have to talk about other things such as places, things, events. When children go outside and they go and talk to their other friend or anyone, or in, even in the future, describing, description is very, very important. So description, that's why description is one of the discourse that is addressed in our classroom transaction. As in the case of other discourses, this discourse also has some like different types, like description. It may, as the other day, Hanumantrao sir, travelogue. We have a travelogue in 10th class. So description of a place. When the child is able to describe a place, it graduates itself as a travelogue. Next, describing events at the end of writing narratives. No, describing an event, we'll again end up as writing a narrative or a news report. See, describing event is nothing but writing like a news report. Next, describing a person, it may lead to biographical sketches and at a lower level profile. And describing a process, it become writing recipes. So the classroom process of constructing these discourses depend upon the type of description is targeted and the stage at which the learners are undertaking the task. So when you describe a person, details, so what are the different types we'll see? Describing a person, when you describe a person, details such as who and what the person is, physical attributes, social status, achievements, contributions, personal impressions are to be considered. When you describe, when it is describing an object, then details, what it is, where it is, physical properties, shape and color has to be taken care of. Next, describing a place, scenic details of the location, images, sensory perceptions. When it is describing events, details such as what the event is, where it is taking place, the persons or things involved, the order of events, images, sensory perceptions. When it is describing a process, details such as what is, what it is for, things involved, sequence, etc. can be taken care of. And when the features, when we look into features, it is verbal form to a visual. Creating images in most important is the most important feature. Attributes of size and color position add life to description. And the figure of speech like similes and metaphors decorate the description to give it a rich look. Example, I gave examples like his polished ivory knuckles. Eyes have luster of old sapphires. So this beautiful way of presenting. At higher level, 8th to 10th classes, learners are expected to write a variety of sentences, short sentences, clauses, exclamation sentences with stress, literally, with stress. See, exclamation sentence with stress, literally, it's a magnificent LO. Sentence with stress. Include their own personal reflections. child's own personal reflections can also be included in description. Like the third one, debating and arguing. A debate is an organized argument. When you discuss topics in class or at home and put forward different point of views, this is debating. And in debating, we need two teams, the proposition team and opposition team. When you need something to argue about, this is called a motion. The proposition team starts. The first speaker has to tell everyone what the motion is all about. The opposition team goes next. The last speaker of the team will sum up. Notes is passed to one another to write main points and add or change. The most convincing team will win. So this is a process of conducting a debate. And arguing, what is arguing? Use facts as much evidence as many, use as many statistics also as possible. Use opinions and facts. Listen to other team and comment. Arguing isn't about shouting the loudest. Present your, as we see in our TV channels, they shout loudly and they say it's argument. No, it's not true. It's not correct. Arguing isn't about shouting the loudest. Present your argument in a clear, controlled voice. Don't lose temper. So this is regarding argument. So we can perform this in class at a lower level, even at a higher level. The fourth one, play script. A script is a piece of writing in form of a drama. Drama is intended to be performed. So what is the layout of a script? Title, first the title, next scene, where, when the scene is set, the characters. For example, it must be clearly mentioned, Rahul, aged 32, or Jean, aged 24. Any character who come into the scene after the start should be introduced by enter and exit if the character leaves. These are all indicators. Next, stage directions should be written in brackets. So, in a play script, characters, plot and dialogues. Characters is we have to limited number of characters would be better. If the children are able to write a script with 10 characters also they can, but at initial stage. What I'm saying, limit the characters. Next, plot, conflict. You know the plot, conflict, crisis and resolution. Some issue raised, it is a melodrama occurs and it is resolved at the end. Dialogues, good dialogues. Dialogue delivery is very, very important. They must be louder and clear. The next one, interview. For writing an interview, I request all the participants, please go through our teacher's handbook once. It helps you a lot to understand about interview. Some points I want to present before you regarding preparation of interview. Prepare questions. The children have to prepare questions before the interview. Begin with non-threatening and non-emotional topics. Interview to the person's achievements, ideas, and beliefs. Observe the person's features. Use the feedback principle to restate the views of the person. Don't allow yourself to become the subject and tell your life story. This usually happens. And at the end, another important point, don't argue using persuasive language. So these are important, some important points to be considered while writing an interview, especially in class 10. The next one, essay. An essay is a short piece of writing that discusses, describes, or analyzes a topic. Essays, you know, different types are there. Expository, which means explaining something to the reader. Compare and contrast essays, unbiased discussions, like similarity, discussing on the similarities and differences of on that particular aspect or topic. Next, cause and effect essays. Relationship between two or more events. Cause and effect essays. Argumentative essays. Next, informal. informal essays which are written for enjoyment. Next, critical review. This is very difficult, most difficult essay to write a critical review or opinion. So what are the areas that have to be clearly taken care of while writing an essay? The title first, next the thesis statement, body, conclusion. Appropriate paragraphing with main ideas, supporting details and examples, organization of ideas, maintaining coherence. Here maintaining coherence means pronouns, using linkers, pronouns wherever necessary. If pronouns are not used, we lose linking. Next, presenting ideas without digression. So these are all very simple way I have given you the points, you can understand. Next, eighth one, newspaper article. Newspaper article, it has a headline, usually 4 to 5 words. What is the headline for an article? How many words are there in the headline? This has to be taken care of. Next, you have the byline. Byline says, speaks about who wrote that article. Next, introduction. It will set the scene and summarize the main points of the article. Who, what, when, where, who is the article about, what happened, when did it happen, where did it happen. Next, the body. More details on the event. Next, the quotes. Eyewitness or an expert who has said this, who said that. Who said it? How are they relevant to the event? Next, if you photograph and caption this, it may not be. If children are able to put a photograph and write a caption, it's good. Or else you can leave it. So these are the points. I just want to, tomorrow I'm going to continue it with because from here the real thing starts. Tomorrow my first session will continue with rest of discourses, major and minor, and graphic organizer, how we can use graphic organizers while transacting a text book. So this will be my topic, and Usha madam will deal graphic organizers, using graphic organizers in constructing discourses. So I request participants to please, this is a time for your interaction.
Ma'am, shall I close this, ma'am?
We'll give 1 minute time, at least they can, somebody want to ask any doubt.
Okay, ma'am.
On whole session, right from morning to evening. Only 5 minutes.
I think they are all too exhausted to ask any questions.
Okay, then. Okay, thank you. Okay. Thank you. So I conclude today's session. From my side, since this is the fourth day, we have been trying to understand what we have to do after going back to schools. And I hope all the participants are enjoying this training program. And I thank all the participants who are with me, patiently listening, even at this odd hour. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Prashant sir, you can close. Prashant sir?
Madam, myself, I have host, ma'am.
Ma'am, Jyoti ma'am.
Sir.
Here is one important announcement, ma'am. I just posted a few lines in our chat box. All the participants on Monday have to enter some data like mandal name, teacher name, school name, mail ID, and designation, school UDIS code. Okay, ma'am.
Okay.
They have to, if they enter this data only, they will join with us. Otherwise, they can't. Okay. The Gmail ID and school UDIS code is must. Okay. All the participants, please make a note.
Okay, sir.
I have just posted this, and thanks to Jyoti ma'am, Lata ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Ushasri ma'am, and thanks for Hanumant Rao sir also for joining with us.
Yeah.
And thank you, one and all.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.